Sam Pang, and this is ADBC. Tonight, our two teams will be sifting through the sands of the show like an archaeological dig in an effort to see who can uncover the treasures of the past, or as we call them, answers. Let's meet our teams. Our first guest is from the School of Historical Studies at the Australian Centre. Please welcome Dr. Graeme Willett.
Hi. Graeme.
And our next guest has become such a regular on the show, she now lives in a caravan out the back of the studio. Please welcome comedian Michelle Laurie.
Thank you.
How's the catering in that caravan?
It's great. And really? It's great living at SBS because at 9:30 everyone gets nude. So cool.
That's a caravan yeah. I'd like to be a part of.
Yeah, it's good.
And now to the BC team. Our first team member has a PhD in history from Melbourne University and currently holds a fellowship in the School of Historical Studies at Monash University. Please welcome Dr. Kat Ellinghaus. Thank you, Kat. And next to Kat is one of the biggest names in Australian comedy whose career has spanned film, television and literature. Please welcome him back to ADBC, Mr. Tony Martin.
Thanks, Sam. And Kat, I should explain, see, that's a really impressive list that he's just doled out there, and then for the next 25 minutes I'm just revealed to be a complete idiot. So you'll be doing most of the heavy lifting okay. tonight, and I'll be answering all the questions about Cannonball Run. If they come up.
I hope they do. I tell you, I really hope they do. Graeme, you do a lot of teaching.
Do? Yeah.
What gets a spring in your step on the way to class?
The subjects I really enjoy, the sort of Australian gay and lesbian history subject that I teach, which it's kind of small, but attracts a kind of interested crowd. And it's a great year to be doing it. 40th anniversary of gay and lesbian politics in Australia. So it's kind of got a contemporary ring.
Kat, 20th century American culture is your area of expertise.
It's one of them.
One of them. What is the defining moment of American culture?
We've always known, Sam, that there is a big crossover between American politics and show business. But for me, and I guess, you know, George Bush has taken away from Ronald Reagan a little bit, but you can't get past Ronald Reagan still thinking that he was an actor even when he was president. And there's some great stories about him, you know, getting mixed up, talking to reporters about a bomber pilot that went down in World War II and sacrificed himself to the crew, and yet it was later revealed that this was a movie that Ronald had once seen.
Wow. Isn't it true that 500 years from now he'll really be remembered as the only president who did a film with a monkey?
Yeah.
That will seem a very odd footnote years from now.
It's true.
Let's kick off the show. Each team will be given a brief background on the origins of a popular phrase. Their challenge is to identify the phrase before the clues run out. Graeme and Michelle, you're first. This term, referring to a state of confusion, has several origins. It was used early on in English by Chaucer in relation to a game of dice and generally refers to people who are collectively in a muddle. No, it's not Parliament is now in session. Just thought I'd give you a tip.
It's a state of confusion, but it's like a group. It refers to a group.
People who are collectively in a muddle.
Okay.
Another use concerns two London livery companies. Both were trade guilds that formed in the 12th century and were fighting over which was the sixth company to be established and registered.
What's livery again?
Uniform.
Ah, okay.
Sixth livery.
The number's pretty important.
Ah, ooh.
Fighting over the sixth.
Well done, well done. Sixth. Oh, at sixes and sevens?
That is right.
There
10 points.
Go.
Well done. At sixes and sevens.
There you go.
These two companies, basically, they didn't stop arguing because the older the company, the greater the prestige. So in 1484, the Lord Mayor of the time settled the dispute by saying, you can take it in turns every year. You're the sixth and you're the seventh. So
confusing.
Very confusing.
And the Yellow Pages ad, confusing.
Every year, Kat, you've got to change it.
Yes.
Kat and Tony, here are your clues. This expression relates to considerable personal cost and was probably first used in a military sense.
Gee, I'm an expert on all things military. How about you?
No. I know the Captain and Tennille, really. They're the only military figures whose biography I'm familiar with.
This term is also attributed to 17th century painters and their calculations for the cost of portraits.
Is it at sixes and sevens?
No, it's not.
No. Through the roof? Could that be that this will cost you through an arm and a leg? Will this cost you an arm and a leg?
Yes, that is right. 10 cents. <10%. laughs> Yes. If you wanted a more expensive portrait back then that included limbs, it cost you more. So that's why back at the time, lots of paintings at the time just have a headshot or one arm or one leg. If the painter could paint your arms and legs, he got paid more.
Could you put it on lay-by and just have, like, one arm, maybe come back a few weeks later, add a leg?
No, but... No? But at the time, though, if you were commissioned to paint a kid with his pet octopus, you were set up for life back then. That is effectively how it worked. In that round, Graham Michelle, you picked up 10 points, and Tony and Kat also picked up 10 points. Well done. I show a postcard with a picture on it representing a place in which a well-known historical event occurred. Clues are given along the way. Here's your postcard. What can you see there? Let's go to the back of the postcard. Lying back and thinking about Mother, where are we?
The Bates Motel. No.
You're closer than you think.
Really?
It looks sort of late 19th, early 20th century.
That's exactly right. We are in Vienna.
I think it's Sigmund Freud's place.
I think you'd be
joint,
right.
10
points.
Will.
Well yes. done, Michelle. This is... Specifically, this is Berghasse in Vienna, and this is Sigmund Freud's apartment, and that is his couch.
That his patients lay on.
That is right.
Yes, yes, yes.
Question two, what happened here? Heading off to explore the interior.
Well, he began psychoanalysis that took the 20th century and turned it on its ear, so to speak.
He was the first to think about our childhoods as well, wasn't he, in terms of how they affect our adulthood.
And he really thought that sex was to do with everything.
It was all about
So he
sex.
Finally worked it out, what we've all known.
I guess the real thing he did was kind of take us beyond the surface and the obvious to the unconscious. So now we take this for granted, that you think about... You know, why is somebody really doing that? And what does that really mean? And I guess that's Freud's kind of major breakthrough, that he forces us to think suspiciously about ourselves and everybody else.
And wasn't he the first person to suggest that everyone had different dreams? Because up until then, it was assumed that there was, like, one TV channel. Everyone was having the same dreams. And then Freud went, no, it's more like Foxtel. Some people have got the UK Comedy Channel going. Some people have got the Discovery
and
Network.
There were different packages within everyone's
different
dreams.
Different packages,
right?
Exactly.
Oh, gotcha. That
richer
makes
people
sense.
Could afford a wider range of dreams, apparently.
There will be complaints. This is just... What is...
Well... I did ask about the mother, and who would have thought that it could be explained through animation? That's, you're watching ADBC, and we'll be back with more right after this.
Get more fun out of your computer and play the ADBC online quiz at sbs.com.au/ADBC.
Welcome back to ADBC. We're currently, the AD team of Graham and Michelle are on 20 points and the BC team of Kat and Tony are also on 20 points. Well done. Wow. First Freud, now Jung. Teens will be shown a symbol and then ask some questions about the historical and modern day significance of that symbol. Buzz in when you think you're onto something. Here's your symbol. Now... No points here. Anyone want to take a stab at what this symbol means?
It's shortly after the invention of the motor car. 1907, I think, possibly.
It's somebody ordering a drink.
Yes.
Just the one.
Just the one. One and a half.
One and a half.
It means up yours.
It does mean up yours.
And I think, and I'm not sure if I'm getting it confused with the good old forks, and I think the forks should be brought back.
Yeah.
For one thing.
The forks?
Yeah, the forks need to come back. Yeah, just... I mean, that's really aggressive, but the forks are just a bit of, you know, a bit of fun.
How did that become less offensive than the one?
I don't know. Because I gave my dad the forks once and I got a flogging either way, so it doesn't really... It was still offensive at ours. But I can't... One of them is from a battle where if you got captured... I think it's, like, probably the French and the Germans at it again. And if you got captured, they cut off some of your fingers. So...
You couldn't do the forks anymore.
Right.
So hence the emergence.
Something like that. It was like showing them that you still had that finger or those fingers.
I can tell you, Michelle, that in the Battle of Agincourt in 1415, the French and the English were involved in a battle, and one of the countries made a threat against the other one about what they would do to the archers once they'd won the battle.
Like, is that an archery finger? You need that one?
You do. The French said to the English that once we win this battle, we're going to remove the fingers of your archers just to rub it in.
Right.
However...
Managed to lose the battle.
They did.
That was a mistake in retrospect.
How do we think that the British archers responded to the French?
Showing off their fingers.
That's what they did. I gave them a wagon load of rude fingers. This question's for points. And it concerns the Latin two-word term for the symbol. I'll give you the second word. It is impudicus. What do we think the first word is in Latin?
Fingerus.
Fingerus? You're not that far. You're not that far off, though.
This
is for 10 points. Buzz in if you think you know it, if you've got an answer.
Digitus.
Digitus is correct. Well done. Yeah. Digitus impudicus is the Latin word.
A lifetime of not learning Latin. It finally came into existence.
And both Caesar and Caligula used it all the time.
Really?
Yes. In that round, Kat and Tony, no points. But Graham and Michelle, you picked up 10 points. Well done. For this round, our resident chef, Friendy, has prepared a meal in accordance with an ancient recipe. Teams have the option to taste if they want, but you don't have to. Friendy, what's our dish tonight?
Well, actually, tonight, Sammy, we haven't got food. We've got something liquidical.
Thank you, Friendy. Enjoyed that, if only for you saying the word liquidical.
It's room temperature.
OK, teams.
It smells like my husband on a Saturday night.
Really? Is that the correct answer?
Interesting. Well,
for 10 points, what is in it? What do we think's in this drink?
Well, if it's my husband, it's Jim Beam and half a pizza. Is that what it is?
Hang on, Sam.
Yes.
Are you sure that Friendy didn't just get in late and go, bugger it, I'll just give them Kahlua and milk? That's historical.
Between the two of you, you are on the right track as to what's in this.
It's whiskey, right?
Yes, whiskey is one of the ingredients. Graham?
Milk?
Yeah, it's kind of grainy.
Yes.
Yeah, in a not good way.
More, please, Friendy.
Grainy and honey-y.
And whiskey-y.
So whiskey and oats.
Yes, whiskey and oats. I think between the two teams, I'm going to give you both 10 points because you've tasted it and whiskey and oats and oatmeal has all come out. So that'll do. 10 points. Well done.
Thank you.
Honey and oatmeal broth, actually, to be precise.
Broth.
Yes, broth. The oatmeal is mixed with water and then skimmed off the top. And, of course, you can use the leftover oatmeal to make porridge. For another 10 points, where do we think this drink is from? Kat?
Well, with not only the whiskey and the oats, but with the parsimonious skimming of the oats off the top and saving for later, I would say Scotland.
And you would be exactly right. Well done, Kat. 10 points.
I was going to say Scotland, but just because you used the word porridge, I thought that was the giveaway.
I love that she used the word parsimonious.
Oh, yeah.
Beautiful.
Yes. Yeah.
On one take as well.
I know. I'm Scottish-Australian, that's all right. I'm copying it.
So you'd obviously know what parsimonious means,
absolutely.
If you're Scottish-Australian.
It means tight-assed.
This is a Scottish drink called Athol Brose. And it dates from the 15th century.
What, this particular glass?
Now, in Scottish folklore, the Earl of Athol used the drink in a cunning plan to trap the renegade Ian MacDonald. How do we think he did it? For 10 points, this is. What did the Earl do with the bros to capture the renegade MacDonald?
You could set up a mock nightclub And obviously you could have spiked Athol Broses's for everybody. That's not it, is it?
We're no, not... it's not it, but you're not that far.
You could spike it.
You could spike his porridge with it, because it's already porridge.
Just have some more, yeah.
Gee, that last round is going to be interesting. Yeah. Isn't it? We finish these. If I say to you that the king put it in a well, that's what
Holy
he did.
Holy moly.
And MacDonald lingered there too long and was captured.
He lingered there.
lingered, of course, lingered. Meaning got drunk on Athol Brose.
Yeah.
Obviously, very would have been a very popular well. Would have had a two-bucket minimum, I'm imagining, at some point.
This drink is still part of military traditions and ceremonies, and the visiting royals are often served Athol Brose, which is why many don't stay that long, I'd say. Thanks, Friendy. How do you think we went? That round, Graham, Michelle, you picked up 10 points. Kat and Tony, you picked up 20 points. Well done. This is ADBC, and we'll be back with more right after this. Welcome back to ADBC, where the competition is fierce and, for once, close. Graham and Michelle are on 40 points and Kat and Tony are also on 40 points.
Pretty close.
So you're a real chance of making some history tonight, Tony, by actually winning.
There's still plenty of time to cock it up.
Teams will be shown a shot of some currency.
Oh, right. I thought we were going to be shown the Pamela Anderson and Tommy Lee video. Sure, fine.
This is the Australian $1 note.
There it is.
Question one.
Sam, I think young people watching wouldn't realise how big our currency actually was back in the 1970s.
Yeah, cars were bigger in those days. You needed a Valiant just to carry your wallet, you know.
Question one for 10 points. Name the years it was in circulation. Kat.
Oh, I only know half the answer, but it's because I remember because I was in grade six. I think it was 1984 that it went out of circulation, but I'm not sure about when it began.
Kat, that is half right. That's when it went out of circulation. I'll give you 5 points for that. Well done.
I know the start date, which is 1966.
Yes.
The 14th of February, 1966.
Is it written on here somewhere?
1966 is correct, Graham. Well done. I'll give you 5 points. Question two for another 10 points. Describe what's on the note. Graham.
Various Aboriginal images, including kangaroo, goanna, a hunting scene.
Tony?
I think they've got the story wrong. The story is, of course, the story of the Aboriginal people coming here from Asia. I think they came from Asia 30,000 years ago. And here they are arriving, and here's the people who were there before them saying, Asians go home, in their native tongue. Thousands of years ago. Is this even vaguely right?
Graham, are you sure you don't want to change your answer?
Yeah, it's OK.
But you have further to that.
It's probably the only currency in the world that's got genitals on it. Those gentlemen off to the right, top right.
That's a reference to the ancient Australian art of puppetry of the penis, first seen 30,000 years ago.
Wow. You really don't want to ruin your track record too and try to win tonight, Tony. It's the funeral of the legendary hunter from Arnhem Land, Garum Muringu, or the first man, and he has been killed by a snake at a watering hole as he prepared some kangaroo meat.
Nice.
Question three. The artwork is by renowned Aboriginal bark painter from Arnhem Land, David Malangi, and the use of this artwork was controversial. Why? Tony and Kat?
I don't think they'd asked poor David's permission to use his image. Is that right?
That's exactly right. 10 points, Kat and Tony. Well done.
Right.
Oh, no.
The Reserve Bank had assumed the painter was, quote, anonymous and probably long dead.
It's kind of sad, really, because they went out of their way to kind of create a currency that wasn't the same boring old stuff, you know, the kings and queens and the great economic heroes. So they went for Indigenous issues and kind of motifs.
Yeah, they've obviously tried to make a statement about inclusion of Indigenous culture, and they're not bothered to find out who painted it.
The bank's attempt to make up for its mistake actually became the first step towards the recognition of what?
It would be something to do with, I guess, the legal right of people to own their own intellectual property, so perhaps copyright law?
Yes, exactly. Aboriginal copyright in Australia was established on the back of this. Well done. 10 points to Kat and Tony. It's time for our final round. This is our fast buzzer round, equivalent to the old fast money round, but without the money. Question one. Scotland attempted to colonise Panama in the late 1600s. Kat.
Fact.
That is a fact. It was a disaster. Most of the settlers died there. 220 years later, the Panama Canal was set up with the same concept in mind.
Go, my people.
Question two. In September 1914, Parisian taxi drivers saved their city from the rapidly advancing German army.
That's fact.
Fact. 600 Parisian cabbies responded to the call for help transporting soldiers to the front.
But they went in such a long direction.
Sorry. They didn't indicate. It was a nightmare.
And they did put the meter on.
Yeah.
Question three. When he reformed the calendar, Julius Caesar took 2 days from February and added them to his namesake month, July.
True. Fact.
Fiction.
Never mind.
Question four. Starlings and sparrows were introduced into North America by a fan of Shakespeare who wished to bring to the US all the birds mentioned in the bard's writings. Fact or fiction?
I just want that to be fact.
And really? Michelle wants it to be fact, and it is a fact.
Yay, yay. That's so great. Who bought cane toads and why?
What play mentioned?
New York pharmacist Eugene Schleffen released the birds in 1890 and 91 into Central Park. Question five. According to legend, the thistle became the national emblem of Scotland after barefoot Viking invaders trod on the plant and screamed out in pain, alerting the Scots to their presence. Tone.
It's fiction. Why would Vikings be barefoot? Why would they? Surely they've got giant helmets with horns on. Surely they're wearing shoes.
According to legend, though, Tone, it is a fact. It is a legend that that happened.
Oh. Tough break.
I'm sympathetic with you there, Tom. I'm kind of happy that you might not win. Question six. The Braille alphabet was based on an alphabet invented for military use. Fact or fiction?
Fact.
That is a fact. Fact.
Looks like it should be. Dots and dashes and stuff.
In the early 1800s, French artillery officer Captain Charles Barbier invented the raised dot alphabet as night writing to avoid having to light lamps.
And like the internet originally for military use, and now both, of course, used mainly for pornography. I haven't seen any of that Braille porn. It's very fantastic gear.
Braille pornography. What a way to almost finish the show. Question seven. In the early 1900s, the breakthrough cure for syphilis was giving the patient malaria. Kat.
I think that's fact.
That is fact.
Wow.
Yes. Nobel Prize winner Julius Wagner Jurek infected patients with malaria, causing high fever that killed syphilis bacteria, then treated them with quinine for the malaria and gave them the all clear.
No, I think he had to treat them with gonorrhea for malaria. It was an endless cycle. It was a nightmare.
Hence the invention of Braille pornography.
Whoa, feel this one.
He was never out of work, was Julius. He was very busy. Question eight, final question. Most of Shakespeare's plays were published after his death. Fact or fiction?
Oh, sorry, darling. You go.
Fact.
That is right, darling. Oh. Fact. That is a fact. The first folio is the first published edition of the collected works of Shakespeare, published in 1623, 7 years after his death, and includes 36 plays, 18 of which, including Macbeth, had never been printed before. Graham and Michelle, you finished on 95 points. And Kat and Tony, you also finished on 95 points.
Wow. So we didn't lose.
Yes, Tone. So congratulations, Tone. You didn't lose. Well done. And so I'll just go down here. Luckily, I have one final question.
Oh.
One final fact or fiction.
Tiebreaker.
Though I would argue, if one of you buzz in and get it wrong, you're both still on 95 points.
Fact.
Yeah, we win. Like the tie. Yeah. Stay tied.
Napoleon was of average height for a Frenchman of his era. Fact or fiction? Michelle.
Fact.
Fact. Well done.
Yay!
He was about 5'6". We'd like to thank our guests tonight, Graham Willett and Michelle Laurie. Thank you very much. And the BC team of Kat Ellinghouse and Tony Martin, thank you very much. Thanks for watching ADBC, and remember, those who do not learn from history are condemned to repeat it. With that in mind, we'll be back next week to do it all over again. My name was Sam Pang. Good night.